What a blessing for a mom to sing with her girls. Thank you so much. That was beautiful. Welcome back, everybody. I'm glad you came. It's a sacrifice to come to a week of prayer every night. It means you have to give up stuff that you could be doing. But Richard and I have learned that when we invest in our spiritual experience and our spiritual growth, it is always worth it. Always, always, always. So God is going to bless you because you came.
Especially when we invest in people.
When we invest in people. So tonight we are talking about connecting our children to Christ. Gaining their hearts in true obedience. And we're going to look at how to do that. Before we begin, can we just bow our heads briefly? Heavenly Father, thank you that you look at our hearts and you see where they are at. May we be willing to take a look at our children's hearts and see where they are at so that we can do the work that needs to be done in their lives. Pray that you'll bless us now with your Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name, amen. Proverbs 20 verse 11 says, even a child is known by his doings, whether his work be pure and whether it be right. Even a child is known by his doings. What that verse is saying is, when we look at our children's actions, we can tell where the heart is. So we're going to break this apart this evening and examine this. Now, some of it may seem a little bit unpleasant because sometimes when we do take a look at our children and really take a good look at them, we realize, oh, this is not such a pretty sight. This is not as good as I thought it was. But can we see it as diagnostic rather than discouraging and hopeless? Because unless you have a diagnosis, you can't find a remedy. So let's look at this as diagnosing where are our children's hearts so that we can apply the remedy. So the secret to raising godly children lies in gaining the hearts and their wills. Their hearts and their wills. So this should be the purpose of all our training and discipline. Are you going for the heart? To get your child connected to Christ. Because when our children are connected to Christ, we will see a difference. We'll see a difference in their behavior, their actions, their attitude. We'll see it. And so we get a good, pretty good indication of where the heart is by the outward behavior. If we really want to change our children's behavior, then we've got to go deeper because the Bible does tell us that for out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaketh. So God wants that for every one of us, to have our hearts surrendered to him. But as parents, we have the responsibility of bringing our children to Christ and teaching them how to surrender their hearts to him because they don't know how to do it themselves. But the tricky thing is that unless we know how to do it with ourselves, we can't help our children surrender their hearts. So that's why we began last night with, it begins with me. My heart needs to be surrendered to Christ so that when I'm surrendered to Christ, I can then bring my children and get their hearts connected with him too. So we want children who are being obedient from the heart. We don't want children who are sitting down on the outside but standing up on the inside. And that's very often what we do when we only deal with behavior. And that's why we don't see a change and transformation in our children. And remembering that the heart is the thoughts and the feelings. So where are your children's thoughts and feelings when you are working with them?
Okay, so since the outside is an index to the inside, we want to take you through a piece of scripture that is pretty, like Jen said, can be pretty gruesome when we use it to look at ourselves. And it's the verses just preceding the famous Galatians 5:22 to 24. And we want to go through that because one day we were looking at this auditing thing, looking at our kids, and we actually took this passage and took each of those words and we broke them down. We looked them up in dictionary, looked them up in Strong's Concordance, and basically got the definition of what these words mean. So to give us an idea, and I know last night we spoke quite in depth in the beginning about we realize that we're living in a sinful world and sin is our big problem. And yet, if we as parents do not become intentional about our parenting and we do not focus and zone in, then parenting is just going to happen. And then our kids just happen to grow up and then the cycle just happens to repeat itself generation after generation. So somewhere along the line, we as parents, if we want to be earnest and sincere and recognize not just the fact that on the one hand, we're sitting in a very degraded world where sin is just rampant. It's actually very scary when we look at things. But we as Adventists and as God's people need to look at the other side and see the demand on God's people. God is looking for a people that can represent his character. That's serious. And that's heaps serious responsibility on you and me as parents. And do I need to remind you that maybe some of us our age and a little bit older, maybe we may not see the Lord come. But I think our children and our young people in this setting, man, if they don't see the Lord come, then I don't know how our world's going to make it. So what I'm saying is we've got two things. We've got to become earnest and sincere, but at the same time, we need to recognize the high calling and privilege that we have as parents. Mm. This must not just be seen as a daunting thing. We really need to embrace the fact that there's going to be no generation before that's going to be called to stand in such a way. And are we able and willing to give them that foundation? So it's with that context that we're going to look at Galatians 5, 19 to 24. If you have your Bibles, you're welcome to open them. Otherwise, just sit and we'll take you through each of those words and we will break them down one by one. And we'll come back to the end of the passage when we're done with those words. So Galatians 5, 19 begins with the following words. It says, "Now the works of the flesh are manifest, which are these." Okay, and then it's going to give us a list. So we're going to start with the first one. And the first word in that list is adultery. Now, on the face of it, when you think of adultery, what's adultery got to do with my kids? Come on, this is a bit far-fetched. But when you break it down and you look at what leads to adultery and what becomes adultery is unfaithfulness. Hmm. Unfaithfulness in home chores. You see, we're talking about character. Jen has spoken about the heart and that from the heart, thoughts and feelings come. And as we explained over the weekend, and for those of you that weren't here over the weekend, thoughts and feelings produce our actions. Actions repeated form our habits. Our habits form our characters, and our characters determine our what? Our destiny. This is the basis of what we need to focus on. And remember, folks, we said we want to get to the root cause of our problems. We don't want to keep swatting symptoms. So this is why we're looking at this stuff. So if in my home, as a parent, I am teaching my child to be unfaithful in home chores, what am I teaching? I'm teaching negative character. Every time I let my child get away with unfaithfulness in the chores, I'm teaching negative character, rather than instilling positive character. So things like lying and deceit, if we let our children get away with stuff like that, and, you know, I think all people need to learn, especially children need to learn about deceitfulness and about lying. It's something that's in our nature, and are we just overlooking it? And if we are, the results are scary.
Okay, the next word on the list is fornication. And that comes from the Greek word porneia, and we know where that leads us to, pornography. We may think that pornography is not a big thing. It is a big deal. And kids as young as 7 and 8 are getting involved in pornography. It's available readily to everybody. But let's take it a little bit further. It's not just pornography or sexual involvement, it can also just mean that your child is ruled by their appetites and their passions. They have a lack of self-control, and they may have impure thoughts and words.
So that's what can lead to...
To fornication later on.
Okay, uncleanness. There's some really crazy words we're going to come across. Uncleanness simply referring to impurity, morally or physically. You can be untidy and messy in your home. You can be untidy in your dress. You can even be untidy and messy in your work. So what are we teaching our children?
Lasciviousness, which means simply lewd, lustful, overly concerned with sex, immoral, and follows feelings.
Idolatry, too great attachment or devotion to something or someone. So it comes out in stubbornness, in serving of self. It comes out in overly interested in fashion and following fashion, etc., etc.
Witchcraft, independent of restraint. Don't tell me what to do. I'll do whatever I want to do. We see that in our homes. We are told in 1 Samuel 15:23, for rebellion is as the sin of witchcraft. So if you have rebellion in your home, it's as bad as witchcraft.
I don't want to.
I won't. Never mind, I don't want to. I won't.
I won't. Remember, we spoke. Have we spoken about subtle?
No. That's coming.
We're still getting there. Okay. Hatred. A deep dislike or wishing to harm another.
We see that
more and more amongst our children today. Mm-hmm. It's becoming so prevalent. And again, TV, movies, video games, crazy.
Variance. Quarreling, contention, not in harmony or agreement. We see plenty of that in our homes between our children, don't we? Arguments, fighting, disagreements.
Paul uses the word emulations. Trying to be like or be better than others, and this is equivalent of jealousy, or even following trends no matter how ridiculous they are. If you see what's going on in fashions and with hairstyles and behaviors, it seems to change every year or every few months. I don't know, I've lost track with it, but this is what helps us become like that.
Okay, and the next word is the word wrath, which simply means passion, fierceness, violent anger, and that is becoming more prevalent in our children.
Strife. The word strife is similar to being bitter, having violent disagreement, or simply arguing or excusing.
Seditions is disunion, stirring up of feelings against lawful authority.
Are these things that we see in the children today? We see it. And if we don't, if we leave it untouched, it's going to develop into these serious issues. And it's actually quite scary when you look at it. Heresies. Opinion opposed to doctrine. Prefer to choose for oneself or you stick to your own ideas.
Envyings, ill will, jealousy, painful or resentful awareness of an advantage or possession enjoyed by another, plus the desire to possess that same thing. It can also mean being unappreciative, fault-finding, and discontent.
The next word, kind of crazy, murders. Our children are murderers? Well, it stems from anger, criticism, and even hatred, and eventually the intentional or unlawful killing of a person. If you just consider the video games and computer games that are out there, I actually happened just to watch a Fox News report this afternoon on, with all this school shootings in the States, some people are now standing up and asking, so, is there maybe a connection with the violence in the movies from Hollywood and all these computer games? And you won't believe it, how some people are absolutely denying it. And then others are adamantly, they're showing scientific proof that, I mean, the Bible is clear, by beholding we become changed. And so, yeah, it's just, it's scary where our world is.
Okay, drunkenness. And we may think, well, none of our kids are drinking and they're not drunk. But do you know that losing your temper deprives you of your reason just as alcohol does? And if our kids are losing their temper, throwing fits, slamming doors, they are actually totally out of control and as good as drunk.
Revelings is the last word in that passage. It refers to rioting, letting loose, being noisy in a festive manner, merry celebration, foolishness, empty amusements, or empty entertainments.
Mm.
Interesting. So the verse, Galatians 5:19, gives you that list, and then it continues and it says this. And such like. Speaking of that list, so there's actually more for us to consider. Of which I tell you before, as have I also told you in time past, that they which do such things shall not inherit the kingdom of God.
Mm.
This is a serious matter for us to consider. Now, in contrast to this list, if and when we and our children are connected to God and filled with His Spirit, we can reveal the fruit of the Spirit.
Mm.
Is that hard to work out, the conclusion to come to? Remember last night we said 1 + 1 = 2. But so often in the Christian walk, we know that 1 + 1 = 2 and we take it for granted. We know these verses. We know the concepts, but we do not act on it. So, the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, and temperance. I want to tell you something. Let's forget about the bad list for a moment and start chewing on the fruit of the Spirit. Think about those words. Think about it. Apply it to your own life. Challenge yourself. Do I possess love? What about joy and peace? Am I patient? It's a challenge. So parents, we really need to be intentional in evaluating our children's fruit. We need to look at their doings, not just about what they know.
Mm.
It's fine if we have in worship twice a day and if our kids go to Sabbath school all the time, etc., etc., and they're learning all the stories in the Bible, that's good. But is it having an impact? Are we taking what we know, and is it coming out? Matthew 7:16 says, "You shall know them by their fruits." In other words, their manners, their conduct, their habits. Are we assessing our children's habits? Do we even know where our children are at in this context? And I promise you, if we are not intentional and if you're not actually looking at it and doing an audit on ourselves and on our children, we aren't going to know. So we encourage you to look. We encourage you to prayerfully look at your children. You see, it is only by helping our children gain that connection which we've been speaking about all weekend with Christ, getting them and training and teaching them how to surrender their hearts in the moment as they struggle with temptation and with sin, that they will actually then be able to resist and crucify the works of the flesh, according to as Paul has just said. And then they can bring on the fruits of the Spirit, which shared the promises. Philippians 2:13. I will cause you to will and to do according to my good pleasure. James 4:7, submit therefore to God, resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Are we teaching our children these things? You see, getting connected with Christ has to do with the heart, as Jen was saying. And in working with our children, we make the mistake by looking at the behaviors. And we think, if I can get my child to sit down, I've arrived as a parent. But if the child is standing up in its heart, what is the use of it sitting down?
Mm-hmm.
That kind of discipline and that kind of parenting does nothing to help the child, but it actually creates rebellion.
It actually feeds rebellion, because that child is sitting there with this attitude, and mom and dad are not happy that at least I'm sitting. We're actually instilling in the child's mind that rebellion is okay as long as you're sitting. Can you see the logic? It seems so simple, the equation, as we break it down, and yet we live with it and we accept it. So, we want to encourage you, in order to get out of this trap of just focusing on the behavior, we have to ask ourselves the question, why is my child behaving in a certain way? Not just that it is, and I must stop it. Get to the why. Because when I get to the why, I can get to the root of the problem, not just dealing with a symptom of a behavior. So, we want to encourage you, ask yourself many over and over, once a week or whenever the Lord inspires you, where is my child's heart right now? Even if there's nothing that's going wrong, be aware, what is the state of my child's heart? Why is he or she behaving in a certain way? Why is my child quiet for the last 2-3 days? Why is my child overly over the top? You see, we spend our lives struggling along, trying to sort out arguments, fights, grumpiness, disobedience, bad words, instead of dealing with the cause of it, and then all of those things can just go out the window in one stroke, if I can get the heart. Give us an illustration, love.
So our home was just like anyone else's home. Our kids fought and argued and didn't like sharing their toys, like most kids do, or don't. But God really helped me to begin looking deeper than the surface and to start dealing with the heart. So at one point when our kids were really young, they used to help me make tofu. We made tofu ourselves from beginning to end. And so the three of them would be at the sink, each doing a process, part of the process. And they weren't yet quite tall enough to even reach the sink yet. So they had to kneel on chairs, and we had one little wooden stool that was only about this high, but it was just perfect to stand on. You didn't have to kneel on the chair and get sore knees. So there was always an argument about whose turn it was for that little stool.
The bunkie.
Yeah, the bunkie, as we called it. So Ashley and Jaden were arguing about whose turn it was to stand on the bunkie. And neither of them were willing to give it up because, of course, the selfish heart, I want my turn. So I decided, okay, they're arguing, I'll send them on a run. So we had what we called a monkey run, where the kids would, we had worked out like a 5-minute run that they had to run on, and that was used as a form of discipline, get rid of energy. Very often kids are disobedient and full of mischief and whatever because they've just got too much energy. So I sent them on this run, but as they came back in, they picked up the argument where they'd left off. And I was like, oh no, didn't solve the problem. Now what? What do we do when we're in that situation? Take away the bunkie.
In other words,
that is what we normally would do, take away the bunkie. But does taking away the bunkie deal with the heart?
We take the tree out of the garden.
Yeah, we take the tree out of the garden.
God put the tree in the middle of the garden.
And he said, don't touch it. Okay, so, which means that in that moment, I have to say, Acts 9, verse 6, Lord, what do you want me to do? Because I don't know what to do now. What I thought would work didn't work. I don't know what to do. But the Lord, he brought it clear to my mind, deal with the heart. You see, out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. So what's going on in here? Selfishness. Jaden's selfish, Ashley's selfish. Deal with the selfishness and the arguing will go away. So take them to the bathroom. We always did our disciplining in the bathroom in private where we were not in front of anybody else, even other family members. So I began with Ashley and I spoke to her about, well, you know, selfishness does not make you happy. It's better to let someone else have, you know, and I prayed with her and got her to be willing to say, okay, she doesn't need to have the bunkie anymore. So she was fine. She walked out of the bathroom, brought Jaden back in, did the same thing with him. Took a little bit longer because he was a little bit more strong-willed. But he also got to the point through talking with him, reasoning with him, praying with him. Now, please remember, my kids were over the age of 7 by this time, where they are able to be reasoned with. You cannot use this process with a 2-year-old. 2-year-old is a different story because they are not able to reason. And so he also got to the point where he was willing to let go of what he wanted. So we came out of the bathroom and I said to Ash, hey Ash, JD says you can use the little stool now because he's okay with it if you use it. And she said, ah, Mom, it doesn't matter. I don't need it anymore anyway. And so she was whistling and talking to Ryan and carrying on. And the whole process, the whole argument was just over, gone. And I was like, wow, wow, look what God can do. But you know, the beautiful thing is that when you deal with the heart, you deal with the heart, which means that we're not going to have self cropping up over here in a few minutes' time because we haven't yet, if we don't deal with the heart, we haven't subdued self. So it's going to crop up somewhere else. There's going to be an argument about something else. There's going to be crosswords. There's going to be some form of self is going to crop up somewhere else if you haven't dealt with the heart. And when you do deal with the heart, the rest of that day, there was peace and harmony in our home. There were no arguments. There was no crosswords. There was no backchatting. There was nothing. Hearts were submitted. When we get our children's hearts, we get everything when God has those hearts. So, in thinking about how we get our children connected to Christ, there are a number of ways that we can connect them to God.
Before you go there, can I come back and raise the thing about removing the bonkie or the tree?
Yes.
I hope you guys recognize what we said there. And Chris, you owning up as a faithful parent, we like to childproof our homes instead of
home-proofing our children.
Instead of home-proofing our children. Mm. We must always remember the bonkie and the issue around the bonkie was an opportunity to get to the heart and teach victory. If you take the bonkie away, you've lost an opportunity.
Mm.
And the heart is still not right. They'll start arguing about who's got the green cloth that they use to squeeze the water out of the pulp. It will come up in some other way. Let's not be afraid of dealing with the issues. Mm-hmm. The sooner you deal with the issues and train the child to surrender, the sooner your problems are gone. Remember our quote on Sabbath? We can save ourselves, how many? 1,000 struggles with the passions of the heart. And this is our goal. This is our aim.
And I think sometimes as parents, we just avoid dealing with the heart because we don't feel like it and it's going to take time and it's confrontation and I just don't want to do it. I'm too tired. But what we're doing is when we just give in, and let them have their way, all we're doing is strengthening that self. We're strengthening self in them, which means the next time you confront that self, it's going to be harder. So when they're ripping the Tupperwares out of the cupboard and it's not what you want them to do, but you just leave it because you just couldn't be bothered, you're just making tomorrow harder for yourself. Because tomorrow you're going to say, no, I don't want you in that cupboard. But yesterday I could. What now? All of a sudden. And so we need to, it's like you've got to just pluck up that courage, face what you've got to face and do what you've got to do because actually you're investing in tomorrow. You're investing in tomorrow by being firm today and by confronting selfishness and arguments and the heart issues.
You know, we're not just doing that. What we're also doing, we are investing in what we as Adventists believe. Hello? Christ's character revealed in his people before he can come.
Mm-hmm.
That's the gospel. Mm-hmm. Not rocket science. And this should be exciting you and me. We should be bringing more bonkies and creating more trees in the garden so that we have got opportunities to teach our children,
not avoiding them. Now, I'm not saying let's lead our children to temptation. We're not going there. But use the opportunities that God gives you and see them. Man, today I've got an opportunity to prepare a child for the kingdom. And if that child can stand up and represent God, that child will represent God to the world, and that's what's going to bring people in. Not just handing out DVDs. Matthew 24:14, we said, and when this gospel is preached in all the world for a witness, then shall the end come. You see what we're working towards? By parenting in the Spirit and doing it the way that that God is trying to get through to us, we are being true to what we believe as Adventists. It's a privilege, and I know this is tough, and I know parenting is hard, and we struggle with consistency, but we need to see it as a privilege. Mm. It's a high calling, but it's a high privilege and honor to be able to do this for God. So how do we, let's get practical. What can we do then to get our children connected?
Okay, well, some of the most obvious things are teach them to have quiet time. And a child of 2 years old is not too young to have quiet time with God. It's just how you do it. So when my kids were really small, they had 10 minutes or so in the morning and they would listen to scripture songs. That was their quiet time. They had to lie in their beds and be quiet. That itself took discipline, because if they're not going to stay in their bed and obey you, then you've got an issue. So we're going to talk about discipline, not tomorrow night, the next night. So I don't want to get sidetracked. But yes, you need to have good discipline in order to start teaching quiet time. So it started off with scripture songs. Then it progressed to reading them a story, reading to them. And as they got older, they would read their lesson study in the morning, and then we would go over it with them afterwards. And then as they got older, they would do it themselves, and we would check in with them every so often. How's it going? What did you learn? How can you apply this to your life today? And then we also taught them how to pray. So kneeling by their bed, saying the words, and letting them repeat after us. And then as they learn how to pray, we use the sanctuary as a model. In fact, I've printed out pictures of the different items in the sanctuary, and each one represents a part of prayer. And so they had a little book that I had printed for them, and they could use that to help them to remember what to pray for and what to pray about. And so we would listen to their prayers, and then as they grew older, we would ask them, so how's it going? Is your praying getting boring? Are you getting stuck saying the same old things? Can we help you in some way? And so we checked in every now and again just to see, is that connection with God happening? Are they learning how? Are they creating the habit of spending time with God in the morning? And then applying what they learned during the day.
Very important.
So, you know, if you ask them to sweep the floor and they say, it's too hard, I can't, then we can say, no, but your Bible says, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. That means you can sweep the floor. It's not too hard. I know you can, because I've seen you hold the broom, and I know the broom is not too heavy for you.
See, so, you're helping them use God's word to make a choice. Oh. You're encouraging them to make a choice, going to God's word. That's making our religion real.
Practical.
Because if our religion is not real, then we learn to play church like we do so often. By the way, that is out. What Jen has just been speaking about is over and above family worship. Mm. Family worship, morning and night, is a golden opportunity to teach your children Christian values. It doesn't have to be long. It mustn't be heavy. You must tailor it for the level of your youngest child. Mm. And just something on Bible studies and that. And as our kids grew up, we went to great pains to get them literature and information that was valuable to them. Because some of our literature is really weak, and it's your choice. You can choose what you can do, but we can recommend my Bible first. Mm.
And young disciple.
And young disciple, powerful stuff. That was my Bible first for what age group was that?
It's all the way up.
All the way through.
Juniors.
I tell you what, I took some of those pamphlets and I worked through those things. The concepts are deep but simple to understand. And then I'd always give you extra reading that you can do at the end. That really gave our children a foundation. I never had that foundation as a kid, so I actually found it interesting. I'd sometimes pick the stuff up and read it for myself. Okay. Teaching them to connect with Christ and have personal study time with Christ. The second thing, and for those of you that are here this weekend, is going to be old hat almost, so review again, it's to teach them to surrender, to submit, to surrender. Steps to Christ, 47, 48, okay? Now, we're not going to go all that way there because you guys know it, but we're going to show you briefly what this entails. Proverbs 4:23 tells us, keep thy heart with all diligence, for out of it are the issues of life. Okay? We must help our children to surrender their ugly thoughts and their feelings to Christ, because this is the root of our ugly actions and behaviors. Yes or no? So, thoughts and feelings. When I can help my child at that level go to Christ and ask God to change my ugly heart, we're teaching them a skill that will save them through the rest of their lives.
Mm-hmm.
So, as soon as I see my child is not behaving the way that we're expecting of them, I need to stop everything else that I'm doing. And I know this is a challenge, a sacrifice as a parent, we're busy, but are we going to rise up to the privilege that we have been given as last day people, or are we going to let it go? So, stop what I'm doing and focus on my child. So, many times one of our children would be feeling irritable or grumpy, like Jen's example of sitting at the sink. And sometimes you could say to Johnny, Daddy wants you to stop being grumpy. Stop being grumpy with your sister. And Johnny can pull himself together and he can stop being grumpy. But other times,
he can't.
He can't stop himself. Just like you and I. We can't stop ourselves. We get irritated with our wives. We get irritated with the people at work. We get irritated with the taxi driver. Sometimes we can stop ourselves, but other times we can't. So what do I do when Johnny can't? Well, it's simple. Take Johnny to Jesus.
Mm-hmm.
And if Johnny's really small, then you get Johnny on his knees. And Johnny's just been ugly to his sister. So you get Johnny on his knees and you say, Johnny, I want you to pray with Daddy. Yes, Daddy. Johnny kneels next to you. I'm demonstrating for you to show you that 1 + 1 does make 2. And we need to get to 2. So you kneel next to your son or your daughter and you pray with your child. So it will be something like this. Dear Jesus, please forgive me for having my ugly heart. Please forgive me for having an ugly heart. And take my ugly heart and give me Jesus' heart. And take my ugly heart and give me Jesus' heart. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Amen. And little Johnny's got a smile on his face. Okay? There are times that doesn't do the trick. But that takes this whole concept of surrender to a deeper level. You may need to pray again. Because I can also pray the prayer as an adult when that taxi driver comes in or whatever the thing is, my pet hate. And sometimes I don't want to really give my heart. It's a case of, Jean, I want you to have this gift. I really, you know, you're really special to me. And this is a gold pen, okay? It's just covered in black paint. Very special gift, and I really want you to have it. Please, take
well,
the
would
gift.
Would you give it to me?
I want you to have the gift.
Let
please
it go.
Have it. You see, what am I doing?
Holding on.
I'm holding on. I'm saying I want to give it, but I don't really want to let go. Do you see the difference, guys? This is, you and I struggle with that. And so does little Johnny. Now, we'll give you more tips later on in the week as to how to help Johnny at that point. But this is what we need to achieve in our children. It sounds so maybe childish and simplistic, but I want to tell you that is where the power of the gospel lies, because that's the promise of heaven, to change Johnny's ugly heart for the heart of Christ. And as long as, Steph's Christ 47:8, as long as we keep doing this, an entire change may be made in little Johnny's life.
Amen.
His character can be transformed. Hmm. Do you see the build-up to it? It begins with the little bonky in the kitchen. Let me give you an example. Yes, like I said, sometimes it takes a bit more than prayer. And I'll give you an example. We were in our reservoir right next to our house. We've got a big reservoir right next to our house, which you always go swimming and play in. And Ryan was about 3 at that stage, and he wasn't interested in the water. And everybody was having fun. It was a nice hot day, so the water wasn't too cold. So I took Ryan in my arms, and I went into the water with him, but he was just niggling and moaning, and he was just being difficult. So I spoke to him directly a few times and said, Ryan, Daddy wants you to stop moaning. The water is not cold. I've got you. You don't need to be scared, blah, blah, blah. And I spoke him through the whole thing, but nothing would help. So I'm there, and I'm saying, Lord, what do I do with this boy? I want him to swim. He needs to learn to swim. And I remember how my mother struggled to get us all to swim. I mean, my mom had a rope around us and was walking on the edge of the same reservoir, walking all the way around for days and days until we were, you know, getting used to the swimming. And I didn't see chance for this, so I thought, no. Lord, there must be another way. You know, we don't need to pass on from one generation to the next. There must be a better way. Well, I was inspired to pray with him, and I did. I did the Dear Jesus Help Johnny's Heart prayer. And it didn't change Johnny's little heart. Johnny wanted nothing to do with this water. So again, I went back to the Lord, and I said, Lord, what do I do? I want you to show me what I must do for little Johnny. And you know, I was then inspired to just pick him out of the water and give him one smack on his leg. And I did. Well, that got Johnny's mind, definitely got his attention, and he saw that this thing is not going to work and that his attitude needs to change, and his attitude did. And I want to tell you something. That little Johnny boy couldn't leave the water alone from that day on. He lost all his fear for water. He couldn't swim. Okay, this didn't happen the same day, but within a week, Ryan was swimming. And when he couldn't make it, he'd just go under the water and just swim and come out over there. I mean, he lost his fear completely.
And he was forever the one who loved the water the most.
He was set free from weeks and weeks of slow coaxing and begging and pleading, and you parent getting frustrated. Why? Just because we followed and we got in connection with heaven. Now, it worked that way that time. A few weeks later, we went for a Sabbath afternoon walk. Same time, 3 years old. And his little legs already starting to get nice little muscles. And, you know, he could walk. They could run around in the yard all afternoon and play. But when it comes to Sabbath afternoon, I'm tired. I can't walk. You know that feeling, guys? And mommy...
Guess who carries him?
Mommy being mommy's...
Mommy.
Picks little Peanut up and starts walking. We get 500 meters away from the house, and we're planning to do a good walk that afternoon. And Ryan is moaning. So, and she's trying to work with him and telling him to stop moaning and you're going to walk. And no, I don't want to walk. And something just twigged in me that I need to turn back and go and save my son and introduce him to manhood. I don't know where it came from. I can only tell you the Lord inspired me, and I did. I walked back. I took my son out of his mother's arms, and I said to his mother, walk on. Oh, but, I said, walk on, lovey. Why and where that sternness came from, but it just came. And she obeyed, and she walked on with the other two kids. And they went around the corner, and I'm saying, Lord, so what do I tell little Johnny? And anyway, I was inspired. I go down on my haunches, and I say, Peanut, Daddy wants you to stop whining. It's really ugly that you whine. But you know what? I really want you to be strong. Look here. And I feel your little leg muscles. I said, you see these muscles? Yes, Daddy. And then I was inspired just to pull my short sleeve up.
And show him your leg muscles.
Well, yeah, I flexed my calf muscle. I said, you see Daddy's muscle? Ooh, yeah. I said, feel it. I said, you feel how hard it is? I said, yes, Daddy. I said, you know what? Your muscle will only get like Daddy's muscle if you walk when you're tired. If every time you're tired, you ask Mommy to pick you up, you'll never get muscles like Daddy. Listen here. That little boy's eyes just go. We walked that afternoon and we did, listen carefully, a 4.5K walk. Not a problem. Mm. In fact, the last kilometer back to the house, all three kids were running and jumping off anteeps and rolling in the grass, and they basically ran home. It was a miracle. Why am I telling you this? We can save our children so much heartache and misery. More so as children when they get to our age. Do you see the verse, the quote that says, you can save a thousand struggles with the passions of the heart. God's promise to us and to our children, folks, is Ezekiel 36, 27, 26, and 27. A new heart also will I give you. A new spirit will I put within you, and I will take away the stony heart out of your flesh, and I will give you a heart of flesh. I will put my spirit within you, and here's the operative word, and cause you to walk in my statutes, and ye shall keep my judgments and do them. We need to claim God's word. But you and I need to believe this before we can teach it and train our children. We genuinely, it's as simple as that. We need to go to God, bring our children to God, and let him do the great exchange. That is the gospel. I know we've repeated it a few times, but believe you me, you may have to repeat it to yourself and to each other a few more times to get it to sink in so that we get into action as parents. As our children grow and mature, and we are teaching them this, and as they learn how to surrender their hearts and how to have and how to experience God's power to change their hearts in the moment, to make them content, then they will naturally begin to surrender their hearts themselves. And I cannot tell you the joy that it brought to my heart one day. Am I stealing a story from you about Ash doing the math?
Mm.
Oh, I'll leave it
He's
for her.
He's stealing my story.
I don't want to steal your story. But she'll tell you the story just now. When she related to me one day, when one of our children chose for themselves, and you'll hear it, there's nothing greater for a parent to see your own child choosing to go to Christ and then experiencing the miracle of the gospel. This is what we need in our church. But, Jen and I have to learn to surrender our hearts first.
Because you can't teach what you don't know and what you haven't experienced Correct. Yourself. You can't pass that on to your children if you don't have it yourself.
I hope as you're listening that you feel the way that we felt when we came across this concept and started practicing. Just standing here and telling you guys about it again, I wish with all my heart that I had this skill when I was a kid. I wish my parents knew and that they could teach it to me. Mm-hmm. It would have saved me a thousand troubles, mm-hmm. literally. Mm-hmm. Think of your life. Just think of the things that we struggle with.
So it is a great blessing once you've taught this to your children and they recognize how good it feels when their hearts are surrendered Amen. And they begin choosing it for themselves. So one day Ashley was busy with her schoolwork, with her math, and she didn't really like math. She struggled with it. And she was, this particular day, she was having a real hard time just doing the math. And all of a sudden, I was busy in the kitchen and she came and she said to me, Mom, can I go to my room, please? And I was like, okay. Why does she want to go to her room? Is she just trying to get out of doing the math? Is she trying to skip school? What's going on here? But I said, okay, you can go. And she stayed away, and she stayed away, and she stayed away. And I was like, what's going on? But I left her. And a few minutes later, she came back, sat down at the table, and she just started to do her maths. And it just flew. It just went. And I said to her, what happened? What did you go and do in your room? And she said, I went to my room and I prayed and I surrendered my will. Because the reality is she didn't want to do the maths. Not that she couldn't do the maths. And when the will is not engaged, life is hard. Life is hard. And even though we want to be free from sin, and our children may want to be free from sin, but very often our wills keep us trapped there. And unless we surrender our wills to God and say, Lord, I'm willing for you to change. I'm willing for you to make me willing to do this maths. Please make me willing, because I don't want to. Make me willing. God comes in, and he does that transformation in us, and he will do it for our children. So sometimes when our children kick against what we ask them to do, it's not because they can't do it. It's because they don't want to do it. So when I say sweep the floor, it's too hard. It's not too hard. I know it's not too hard. It's because they don't want to. Or when I say, let's go for a walk, and they're like, oh, we're too tired. And I know they can't be tired because they've been running up and down outside.
Playing.
And they're not tired. It's just that they don't want to. And when we deal with the will, get that will surrendered. I always explained it to my kids like this. I said, your will is like the gears of your car. If your gears are not engaged, you can press down on the accelerator as much as you like. You're going to go nowhere. You'll make a whole lot of noise, but you'll go nowhere. And I learned to recognize that when my kids' wills were not surrendered, they made a whole lot of noise. Like, I don't want to. I can't. This is too hard. Why can't someone else do it for a change? I did it yesterday. We get a whole lot of noise when the will is not engaged. But get that will engaged and things happen and your car will go places. So don't accept and tolerate, I don't want to, I can't, it's too hard. Those are excuses and they're not valid. Get your child's heart surrendered and take them. We need to bring them when they're in that situation making a noise, bring them to Christ to have their hearts changed. And like Richard said, we need to be connected because we need to know what's going to work today.
Correct.
It may be that one spank that changed Ryan's whole life around. It may be, look at my muscles. You can get muscles like this too. God knows what will motivate our children. And it's not always going to be the same thing. So we have to be connected with him. Shall I do that? No, I'm going to skip it.
Okay. We just had in
private discussion.
A discussion about another illustration.
It's very similar to the one about Ryan, so I'm okay. Going to leave it out.
Conclusion. We need to look deeper than the outward appearance in our children. The hearts of our children is the thing that we need to help them with. Their thoughts and their feelings. The will, the power of choice. Deal with that and the outward behavior will come into line. God, you know, I came across this verse in Proverbs 23:26 once. Where God is speaking, he says, my son, give me thine heart. Mm. I can just see heaven, anticipation and intensity. God desperately wants us to give him our hearts so that he can do the transformation in us. And you know, I've actually used that same verse with my children once before. When there's been a general sort of bad atmosphere, and it's time to have a little bit of a family council about something. And we had those a number of times. We talk about something. And the Lord inspired me with this verse. And I tell you, I was surprised at the response from my children. When just daddy, after explaining the situation that we needed to discuss, and I said to my children, I said, my boys, my girl, I want you to give your heart to daddy. I want you to choose to come on board. Give me your hearts. And I said it just like that. Well, look here. Those eyes just opened up and they connected with me. We need to motivate.
We need to call out. We need to inspire. That's what God is doing with us. Why can't we do it for our children? Let's not always just be hitting on the head for wrong behavior. No, give me your hearts. Cooperate with Daddy. Can you see that we need to do it? Can you see that Jesus wants you to do it? Yes, Daddy. Inspire them. But let's get into their little hearts and help them. God wants a willing heart. He wants each one of us to get the surrender thing right. Why? Because He wants to come and fetch us. Heaven is frustrated. We said the other day, for 173 years, heaven has been busy in the most holy place with the investigative judgment. What are we playing with? May I suggest to you that as Adventists, we plain juggle with truth. We throw it around. We argue about it. But it's time to start walking the talk. God needs a people. And I want to encourage you. I want to encourage you to do for your kids what was not maybe done for you. And no picking on our parents. But somebody's got to stop the cycle. And God is going to empower us to do that.
But there's a warning with that, because if we haven't worked with our children's hearts, that means that self has become strong in them. Correct. So when you begin to confront that self, you're going to have some conflict. There will be conflict. But God, I love Jeremiah 32:27. It says, "Behold, I am the Lord, the God of all flesh. Is there anything too hard for me?" Mm. No. God is able to subdue our flesh and the flesh of our children. And by the flesh, we mean that self that rises up. And I don't want to do what mom tells me to do. And I don't want to. God is able to subdue that. And we need to be bringing our children to Christ.
So we've
be prepared for a battle.
We've had this a number of occasions when you get to this point that many parents that have not done this, and many of us haven't done it because we never even knew about it and we never taught it ourselves. So many parents struggle with the concept, so my children are already old, or they may even be in their 20s or even out of the home. So what do I do now? What do I do now? Well, you make a start. You make a start in your own life. And then my recommendation to you is to sit down with your children, no matter what their age is, and talk to them. And be open and honest with them and say to them, you know what, Johnny, or Johnny, God has shown me something that I never knew before. And I have failed to teach you something that I could have and should have taught you. Be open with your children, no matter how old they are. Tell them about what you've learned, and explain it to them, and then get on your knees and say, Lord, forgive me for missing the opportunity. Forgive me for missing the opportunity of teaching my children not to pick the apple of that tree. Mm. Are we together, friends? Don't let this be a discouraging message. Let it be an encouraging one. We can always come to Christ. And like Jen said, if you're starting late with your children, the devil's not going to want you to get this right. Mm. Believe you me, when you start it yourself, he's going to nail you. You are going to fail. Mm. But a righteous man falls how many times? 7 times. But what does he do? He stays down and grovels? No, he gets up and he comes to the entrance of the sanctuary again. He confesses his sin and he walks with his God in faith to the other end. Friends, we have a privilege. May God bless you as you apply this message to yourself and then transfer it to your children. It is very rewarding. It's the most rewarding thing for a parent. When Jane told me about Ashley with the maths, I'd had a hectic day on the farm, and I came in for lunch and I sat down, and as the kids were clearing the table, she turned to me and she said, "You know what happened today?" When she told me that, I don't think this father's chest had got bigger than it did at that moment. It was a precious, precious reward.
Just to add another story about Ashley. So when she met her now husband.
Yeah.
She really, really liked this guy. She really liked him. And a number of times throughout the progression of the relationship, she came to me and she said, "Mom, if this is not what God wants for me, then I don't want it. I'm surrendering this all to God. Because if it's not from him, I want him to end it now. Because I don't want to do what God doesn't want me to do. I want his will to be done in this situation." And that's actually a very hard thing to do when you're in love with someone, and to be able to say, if this is not what God wants for me, then I don't want it. That's a hard thing to do. And I was amazed that she was willing to go that far and say, if this is not what God wants for me, then I don't want it either. That's the blessed fruit of teaching our kids to surrender. And for the first 7 years, I did not teach her that because I did not know it. So for my first 7 years, I made a mess. But God can come in. When we start cooperating with him, he works, does a work of transformation.
Amen.
And it's just beautiful to see.
Let's pray. Our Father in heaven, thank you that you know all about parenting. We can tell you nothing about it. Thank you that you know how to reach our hearts. And I just thank you that you've given us the opportunity to learn and to become aware of what we can do and how we can have victory in Christ. Lord, I pray this evening that each of one of us sitting here who may be feeling the burden for our children and maybe the opportunity is pretty much out of our hands at this time to introduce this concept and to teach and train our children. But Lord, it's not too late to pray for them. And I just ask that heaven will come near. And as we approach you and seek this walk with you, that you will empower us and that you will give us the strength to build our children's characters in this way. Help us, Lord. The fight is getting ugly. The devil is really angry and he's throwing everything at our youth and at our children. Mm. And we ask that heaven will set up a standard and empower us, Lord, to do our bit, I pray. Please, don't leave us, Lord, and save our children, I pray, is our prayer in Jesus' name.